Ah, the eternal debate between MacBook Air and MacBook Pro. Long gone are the days when this was as simple as just deciding between two different models. These days, you've got to consider multiple sizes, chip options, and configurations, and many times existing in similar price points. But don't worry, I got you. Hopefully by the end of this video, you'll know exactly which MacBook is right for you. What's up, everybody? Luke here, long time no see. We're in a different space here in the Digital Trends office. It's been a while, so let me know what you guys think of this setup and settle in because I've just come off reviewing the new M4 MacBook Pro and it's definitely shaken up the lineup a bit, which is why we wanted to make this video. And just as a quick note, I'm going to give you my advice as if I were talking to a friend or a family member. I'm not gonna try and upsell you on the newest, flashiest thing. In fact, I wanna save you as much money as possible. And I think as you'll see, the MacBook lineup right now actually allows for a lot of room for doing just that. So let's get into it. To start off, let's paint the big picture here. You've got two MacBook Pro sizes, the 14-inch and 16-inch. Meanwhile, you have two MacBook Air sizes, the 13-inch and 15-inch. The MacBook Pro was just updated with the M4 chips, with options for the M4, M4 Pro, and M4 Max. The MacBook Air, on the other hand, gives you the options of the M3 chip, M2 chip, and yes, even the M1. We'll get to that in a second. So let's start with this, the MacBook that I believe most people should buy, or at least the one that all MacBook shoppers should consider first, and that's the M2 MacBook Air. Yes, this over 2-year-old laptop is where I think you should start. And the reason is because right now you can buy the base model of the M2 MacBook Air for around $800, despite the fact that Apple still sells it for $1,000 over on their website. But at $800, it just might be the best laptop to ever be sold at that price, especially in terms of battery life and performance. And especially now that it starts with 16 gigabytes of RAM. If you remember, this was the first model to receive that super thin design, just 0.44 inches thick, which is still one of the thinnest laptops you can buy. And this is also the one that got the slightly larger screen, thinner bezels, upgraded 1080p webcam, as well as the reintroduction of the MagSafe power connector. All good things in my book. But you need to be careful when buying this laptop. As I mentioned, Apple recently increased the starting RAM for all the MacBook Airs to 16 gigabytes without raising the starting price. And so you'll still find a lot of retailers out there that haven't got the memo yet and are still selling 8 gigabyte models at $1,000, and you do not want to do that. But so long as you're careful, you should be able to find 16 gigabyte models as low as $800, and this isn't just for college students and first-time buyers anymore, as the MacBook Air was in a previous era. It really is the go-to option. If your work primarily involves a browser and a few apps, video calls, messaging, the typical office or school workload these days, it's the one most people should buy. It's gonna have software support for many years, including all the upcoming Apple Intelligence features. Now, before I introduce the MacBook Pro into the equation, you might be wondering, why am I pointing to the M2 MacBook Air rather than the M1 or the newer M3? Well, I think those are both fine options, but they have a bit of a niche audience at this particular moment. The M1 does still serve a demographic out there, despite the fact that it's 4 years old. There's a reason it's still being sold at third-party retailers, sometimes as low as $500. However, I'm finally at a place where I no longer recommend it as a capable computer for the average person to buy, such as a college student or a remote home worker. That's despite the fact that the refurbished models are selling for around $500, which is, again, a really killer deal. But I'd only recommend it for maybe a high school student or as a secondary travel device that's not used very often. The thick bezels, the 720p webcam, and most importantly, the exclusively entry-level configurations that are available make it a hard sell for anyone else. It still honestly does get pretty good performance and battery life though, so I'd certainly recommend this over a Chromebook or any of the $500 Windows laptops out there. As for the M3, a lot of the performance increase is on the GPU side, and it is notable. I just don't think that's the reason people are going out and buying MacBook Airs these days. Outside of that performance bump, it doesn't make any huge changes to the formula, it's just more expensive. But most importantly, the M4 update to the MacBook Air seems like it's just around the corner, rumored to launch in early 2025, so If you like the idea of a MacBook Air with a little more performance, I'd suggest waiting until the M4 comes, at least so the prices drop on the M3 model a bit. Okay, I know that was a lot just about the MacBook Air, and I know you came to this video to see how the Air and the Pro compare to each other. And honestly, that's where things get really interesting. Okay, so the M4, the M4 Pro, and the M4 Max MacBook Pro models are out, and they are inevitably going to be the shiny new thing that everybody wants. And to be fair, I totally get why. The $1,600 14-inch M4 model also now starts with 16 gigabytes of RAM, but also comes with a considerably better 12 megapixel webcam, and the option for a really incredible nano texture glass screen, which if you haven't seen it, deflects reflections in a really subtle and effective way. But here's the question. Do you need a MacBook Pro? That's what it really all comes down to. And the general advice out there is that you really shouldn't even consider the MacBook Pro unless you know you need the performance, largely because of how priced up these things are, especially when you start adding extra storage. And I mostly agree with that advice. It takes really having an honest conversation with yourself about how you plan to use this laptop if you really want to get your money's worth. The MacBook Air, whether it's the M2 or the M3, is actually surprisingly good in creative tasks. So if running heavier applications is more of a hobby for you, meaning you might dabble in it once or twice a week, opting for the MacBook Pro feels like kind of a waste of money. However, if you do edit video, render graphics, train AI models, or produce music for a living, as in you do it all day, every day, the only question really is whether you should get the M4 Pro or the M4 Max. Now, you've probably heard that before, and I wish I could leave it at that. Leave the MacBook Pros to, you know, the pros, and leave the Air for everyone else. But Apple, they're too smart for that. They know that there's money to be made in the confusing middle, which is why the 14-inch M4 MacBook Pro exists, throwing a wrench into this whole otherwise clear-cut decision. This thing starts at $1,600, which sounds like a lot, but here's the thing. When you configure the 15-inch M3 MacBook Air with the same amount of storage, the MacBook Pro is actually only $100 more expensive. And that $100 buys you a lot. I'm talking way more ports, including an SD card slot, HDMI, and an extra Thunderbolt port. And most importantly, using those ports, you can connect up to 3 external displays, 2 of which can be up to 6K resolution and the other up to 5K. For some people, that external monitor support alone is going to be the deal breaker right there over the MacBook Air, which can only support 1 external monitor or 2 if you close the lid on your laptop. Not everyone, of course, but if your workstation involves using your laptop with 2 external monitors connected, the M4 MacBook Pro is your automatic choice between these two. The other huge advantage of the MacBook Pro over the MacBook Air is the display. The MacBook Pro's mini LED display has much stronger contrast, more vivid colors, and a faster 120Hz refresh rate. It's also unrivaled in terms of sheer brightness, being able to extend up to 1,000 nits of SDR brightness when you're working outside, as well as producing some really stunning HDR performance with up to 1,600 nits of peak brightness. And like I mentioned earlier, you get that 12 megapixel webcam, which really is a big upgrade over the 1080p one in the MacBook Air. So just to be clear, for $100, you get more performance, more ports, more external display support, higher resolution webcam, and a much better screen. As you can tell, those aren't features that only creative pros would care about. They're quality of life improvements that most people would probably enjoy. So if you're deciding between these two and need to buy a MacBook right now, the M4 14-inch MacBook Pro is definitely the better option. Now, like I said earlier, an M4 MacBook Air is supposedly due out in early 2025, and that will supposedly include the 15-inch model too. So if you're stuck between deciding on these two laptops and are leaning more towards the Air, maybe because of how thin it is or how affordable that entry-level model is, at least wait a few months if you can. So that's my deliberation on the messy middle of the MacBook lineup, and I hope that helps because really another way to think about it is the M4 MacBook Pro is just for those who like having the most premium laptop but probably don't need the performance. And I am not judging you, there is certainly nothing wrong with that. If Your laptop happens to be your main movie watching device, for example. You might be willing to pay for that better screen alone. So now let's spend a moment talking about what you get when you go beyond the base M4 MacBook Pro, which fortunately is where things get a little less murky. The M4 Pro and M4 Max MacBook Pros, regardless of the size you go for, are actually meant for pros. And look, I've only tested the M4 Pro so far, but it's pretty amazing in the performance improvements it offers. And I can only imagine the M4 Max takes that a solid step further based on how these configurations have worked out in the past. So I can't give you exact performance comparisons here just yet, but it's important to remember the jump from the Pro to the Max has usually been primarily about a boost in GPU performance. So know what applications you're running and whether they actually take use of that extra GPU performance, or else you're totally throwing away $1,000 and probably not getting much for it. And there's one more important thing to consider when you're buying the MacBook Pro, because things do get tricky when you start to throw in older MacBook Pro models into the mix. You really need to be careful if you're doing this. First off, you want to make sure you don't accidentally get an M3 MacBook Pro with only 8 GB of RAM. I'm seeing these online right now for around $1,350, which can be tempting, I know. But considering the fact that Apple charges $200 to upgrade from 8 GB to 16 GB of memory, you're really only saving $50 and you're losing out on all the performance benefits of the M4 over the M3 and things like the better webcam. Now, it gets really dicey when you consider how fast Apple Silicon has improved over the years. Take the base M3 chip, for example, which outperforms the M1 Pro in almost every way, while the M4 is a crazy 50% improvement in CPU performance over the M3. That makes the performance and price comparisons really hard to make, so you have to pay attention to how these things play out. So proceed with caution, yes. But I'm also not saying that opting for an older MacBook Pro is never a good idea. I'm not going to list out every refurbished M2 Max or M3 Max MacBook Pro listing I find, but suffice to say, I've seen an M3 Max MacBook Pro selling for as much as $1,300 lower than the current M4 Max MacBook Pro. And remember, that M3 Max laptop costed full price not so long ago. You're foregoing some performance, especially single core and GPU performance, Thunderbolt 5 support, and some smaller things like what I mentioned earlier, the nano texture screen or the extra nits of brightness in, harsh lighting conditions. But unless you know you'd max out the performance or are just really interested in one of those other features, I don't know if I'd say that's worth $1,300. It's a tough call to make. But that's just me, and I know it can be frustrating to try and game the system and buy at the right time and all that. Sometimes you just need a new laptop and you kind of want to just get it over with. I get it. The good news is that pretty much every MacBook in the lineup right now is good on an established baseline. It's really incredible how Apple has turned things around in the Apple Silicon era. But I think if you follow some of the guidelines I've talked about, you can hopefully try to deduce which is the best option for you and where are the places where you can save a little bit of money. And hey, if you found this helpful at all, do me a huge favor. Leave me a like on the video, a subscribe for the channel, and a comment down below. I love recommending laptops and talking about this stuff. So if you're looking at all these options and you're still trying to figure out which is best for you in your particular scenario, I'll be down in the comments trying to help. Thanks for watching.